brilliant things so we can make money today.
Oh, okay. So I'm going to call you up, Tiara. We did a deal a business 3 years ago on a deal, and was a good deal, but I still owe you $1,500 from 3 years ago, and I'm going to call you up today.
Okay.
Hi, Tiara.
Hey, Claude. How are you?
I'm great. Oh, it's been way too long. We should have spoke much sooner. Listen, good news. I just found this great deal in Boulder, Colorado. I don't think that's too far from you, right?
No, not too far.
Oh, it's a smoking deal. I think we'll make some really good money on this deal. But I'm in North Carolina right now, and I thought of you right away, and we've done deals in the past, and I just wanted to work with you on this deal.
Yeah, Claude, you know, thank you for thinking of me, you know, first and giving me a call. It's just last time we did a deal, you know, you kind of burned me a little bit, and you owe me some money.
You're not going to do any stroking and nurturing here at all, are you? You're just going to punch me in the face, aren't you? I love it. You know, why don't we nurture it a little?
Okay. Oh,
I'm so glad you called me. It's been too long. We both stand to make a lot of money on this deal. That's wonderful. I'm glad you thought of me first, but is it possible we could take care of some old housekeeping or business first? Okay. You never know. Maybe he's a better person today or something, but you're right to go right for it in the beginning. I love that part.
Okay.
So let's do that again. Yeah. It's a great deal. I bet we both make super money on it. I know I got all the information, and I want a joint venture with you like we did in the past.
Yeah, Claude, thank you. Thank you for giving me a call first. You know, it sounds like this is something that we could, you know, really make some money together on and, you know, do something nice together. And yeah, you know, it sounds like this is a great thing that you worked up on. It's just, do you think we could talk about, you know, how last time we did a deal together and, you know, you still owe me like $1,500 from that.
I was thinking about, but you made a lot more. I remember, didn't you make about $18,000 on that deal?
You know, Claude, you're right. Thank you for reminding me of that, that I did. But however, remember we did talk about that. We had the whole deal created and planned out, and we discussed how much you owed me that $1,500, and you're supposed to get back to me after the deal closed. And you know, you just kind of ghosted me. Is there a way we could talk about that?
Things happen. It was really tough. My chihuahuas got sick and things like that. And I'm real sorry about that.
Well, thanks for your apology. I'm glad that you're, you know, calling in and giving me that.
You know what? Can we do this deal and you can take that $1,500 out of my cut on the end?
That's a great idea. However, I don't think that we're going to be able to do that, you know.
Oh, why not? We've done deals before in the past.
Yeah, we have. And, you know, I've been so grateful in the past for your, you know, coming to me. It's just, you know, like I said last time, you did, you know, just kind of leave me hanging and ghost me after we had talked about what, you know, portions and splits we were supposed to have. So is there a way you could get that to me today and then we could talk about something?
You know, it was tough. You know, the pandemic happened and all the politics and my goldfish died and I had to change the oil in my car. And you know how things are.
Yeah, totally. It's just, you know, in order to move forward today, we're going to have to take care of that.
Like I said, I'll take it out of my cut from the deal.
Well, I appreciate you repeating that, but like I said, we're going to have to take care of that today before we move forward with doing the deal.
Ask me a question. Ask the question. How would you like to pay me
today? How would you like to move forward with that? Do you have a debit card or a credit card available right now?
Is that the only way we're going to do business today?
Yeah, it is, Claude.
Oh, wow. I didn't expect this. You were so nice on the phone when we did deals before.
Yeah, you know, and I'm looking forward to us. You know, it sounds like this deal is going to be big. And, you know, I you called me and I could... It's a high possibility that, you know, we could make a lot of money today, you know, doing this deal, JVing it together. It's just, we would have to take care of that today. Do you have credit or debit available?
You won't do this deal with me unless I take care of this today.
Yeah. We got to finish the deal we had going before we move on to the next one.
Wow. Okay. Should I send you a PayPal, a Venmo, or just give you a credit card now?
I can take your credit card information right now.
Boom. And then give her a round of applause. That really happened to me yesterday. I talked about it in the Wednesday role play Wednesday with Justin. That really happened. And that you handle it exactly the way it should be handled. Why? What's the logic? Why do we have to be such mean people?
Because whoever's the nicest person gets paid last or never.
Keep good. Also, the big takeaway from this is keep good notes. Does everybody here have a digital note system? Two I use, just share my screen here. Two that I use, I love, I use notes from, this is the notes section that I use from Apple. This is really great. And you can look up anything right there. The other thing I use, I love Evernote. Evernote is fantastic for taking notes. And you can, all your notes, all your contracts, everything right in there. And you just have to put the name or something that relates to it, and you can search like that. So keep really good notes. So you can't, because you can't remember. How do you remember something from 3.5-4 years ago? I can't. Too many people, too many situations. How about somebody who wanted to do a deal with you a year ago, and they didn't have the money. And they call you back, again, Assad. Hi, Assad, buddy. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing pretty good, Claude.
Yeah.
It's nice to hear from you, man. I think it's been, 6 months?
Yeah. I wanted to ask you more about that lease purchase deal. And you said you could help me with the mortgage and stuff like that. I had a bunch of questions for you, buddy.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. So when we spoke about, in number one, thanks for calling me back. I really appreciate it. I mean, you know, so let me ask, so before we go forward, what was the reason why we couldn't do a deal? You said you didn't have the money last
time. Well, money was real tight then, you know, COVID really screwed up my company's commission checks and things like that. And, you know, but things are looking a lot better right now.
Okay. Gotcha. Well, I greatly appreciate you sharing that with me. It's not just you. I've had probably, I would say, 6 other clients in the last few months that had that same situation. And yeah, COVID, it's really put a lot of people out of business. So, but I'm actually glad to see you're doing good. So let me ask you this real quick. So suppose that, you know, the money wasn't an issue. Can we do business today?
Well, I'd have to, how much am I going to need for that to get into a 3-bedroom condo in La Jolla?
Great question. I don't know.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. I mean, how much were you? What was like your budget or?
Well, I really,
what were you specifically looking for?
I don't really know. I don't, you know, I'm just kind of figuring out. My wife really wants to live in La Jolla and everything. And I think last time you told me I needed like $30,000 minimum option money.
Yeah, that's correct. So So that's what it was. It was $30,000 option money. And then what was your budget for the monthly payment?
Oh, I don't know, about $2,500
a month.
Okay, off the role play. Okay. This is going way too long. Okay, this is, I'm a time waster. I'm the guy who sucks all the oxygen out of the room and exhausts you and frustrates you and keeps you on the phone for 45 minutes. So what's the one thing you want to find out from me in the first 90, 180 seconds?
Do you have the money to move forward?
Go for it. Do that.
Okay. Hey, how's it going, Claude? Hey, so, hey, number one, thanks for reaching back to me. I know COVID's been real hard for you, but let me ask you this. When we spoke earlier, about 6 months ago, you said you you wanted to do the deal, but it was because of the money issue.
It was real tough then. I just didn't have the $30,000 and $3,500 a month then. You know, commissions were being held up, COVID and all those things.
Gotcha. But it's all been, but you're good right now financially.
Well, we're a lot better. Absolutely. We're a lot better than we were a year and a half ago. Absolutely.
Okay, good. So let me ask you this. Suppose
you just we can get you in time that out. Did I just give you a bullshit answer?
Yeah.
I'm manipulating you by giving you ambiguous answers. You now have to get specific. I gave you a macro answer. You need a micro answer. So now's when you shift into, imagine for a moment, Claude, I could help you get in the house and same thing, 30, 35,000 down and 3,500 a month. Are you in a financial position to make that commitment?
Today.
Let me hear that one. Okay. You know, things are a lot better. Thank you for asking. You know, we're doing, you know, things are a lot better than they were a year and a half ago. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, awesome. We're real optimistic about it. That's why I'm calling you. I have a sheet here with about 13 questions that I'd like to ask you though first.
No, I appreciate that. Let me ask you this, Claude. Imagine for a second that we can get you in that home as we promised 6 months ago. We can get you in the home in the next 30 days. Do you have the money to move forward today if we can do that?
I'm pretty sure I can accumulate it. Yeah. My uncle in Milwaukee said he was going to help us out.
Okay. So are you sure? Can you actually do it today?
Well, I'll have to, you know, I'm pretty sure.
And I greatly appreciate Claude though, but unless you have the money, we cannot move forward today.
Okay. Do that a little kindler and gentler. Alan, let me throw this to you. A little kindler and gentler there.
All right, let's try it out.
Okay. I like that Assad fired me and everything like that. But you need to be a little bit more sir. Claude, when you say you're pretty sure and everything, I mean, if we were going to do a deal today, I found you a great property. We needed $35,000. We need $3,500 a month. Can you categorically do that deal today? Because you're talking about your uncle borrowing money and everything like that. Are we ready to do business today or 60, 90, 100, 6 months from today? Off the role play. That's what it should sound like. So let's go right to you, Alan. I want to hear a little bit more assertive. I'm pretty sure I can get the money together. I'm pretty sure.
Can you just clarify, Claude? Because I'm not understanding you. Could you tell me you're pretty sure or are you 100% sure?
Well, you know, I have to look into it. We're borrowing some money from my wife's mother-in-law and we're selling a car and I'm getting a new credit card in the mail any day now with about a 15,000 line of credit. So I'm pretty sure we can 35,000. Is that what we need? Is that option money, by the way? Do we put that all down in one shot? And is that refundable, that 35,000?
Hey, that's a great question, Claude. But you know,
what did I just do? Did everybody see the move I just made?
Yes.
What did I just do? What do we call that? The $10 word. Obfuscation. Obfuscation, I believe. It means when somebody intentionally changes the subject. Why, Tiara?
Pattern interrupt?
It's a pattern interrupt, but what's the logic? Why did I not answer? Alan asked a beautiful question. How come I didn't answer it yes, no, chocolate or vanilla? Why didn't I answer that straight up?
There is no money.
I'm hiding. Right. I don't want to answer honestly. Isn't this what prospects do when they don't want to reveal or answer honestly? What do they do?
They go into a
They obfuscate. They change the subject, or they dance around, or they take, or they tell you a little story or something like that. Don't they do that? And see, I was just doing it to you guys, and I want to teach you this because you still got to get back to the one. What's the one topic we still need to find out, or get off the phone with this guy?
The money.
Money. Back to the money. I'm pretty sure I can, you know, credit. I'm getting a new card, and I'm pretty sure I can. I'll be able to get it together by on or before. You know, I'm thinking Halloween.
Claude, I mean, you're a good guy. You have nice intentions for your wife, and I'm sure it can't be that bad staying in your mother-in-law's attic. But you know, imagine we could move forward today, and let's just say, realistically, when would you actually have the options consideration to put down?
Well, like I said, I'm getting stuff together. I'm thinking possibly by Halloween.
Oh, you know what, Claude? I appreciate that, but unfortunately, there's about 18 other people that are really interested in this house and are ready to do this today. So,
but Claude, you get other, you'll have another property. You get other properties all the time, right? Lease option properties, right?
The market is hot, and you know what, Claude? This might be the only one until Valentine's Day. So I'm sure it's not that bad in your mother-in-law's attic. Oh. And if 35,000 isn't something you come up today, you know, there'll be more properties. With that said, I mean, I do have to go. I have 18 other more people I have to call.
Can I just ask you one or two really quick questions, though?
Send me your email, and I'll send you a free gift. How about that?
Great. Just a quick question before we go, though.
I do have to go, Claude. I'm sorry. My next meeting is at my door. Thank you. Bye for now.
Are you sure? Just one quick question.
I'm sorry. I can't, Claude. I'm really busy.
Okay, give him. That was good, man. That was good. I really hear this stuff. Has anyone else heard the one more question, guy or girl? Have you met that person? Has everybody here met that person?
Yes.
I meet this person every day. And then they obfuscate and they change the subject because they don't want to make a commitment. They don't want to give you a time frame. They don't want to tell you who owns the property, who's the decision maker. They don't want to talk about the money. Or they don't want to ask a straightforward question about whatever you're negotiating. You know, I had one guy, you know, gee, what's the square footage of your house? Well, why is that important? Why do you need to know that? Real nasty. You know, what's that supposed to be about? What are they really saying?
They're not motivated.
Well, they're not motivated, or maybe they're lying. Maybe they're lying. Trust you. Maybe they're not the owner. Has anyone here ever spoken to someone who tried it to sound like the owner, but they were not the owner or decision maker? I've had those discussions. I even have a video on YouTube like that. Good role play, good situation. These kind of calls, these kind of situations come up almost every day to me. People want to keep you on the phone too long and pick your brain, but not answer some reasonable questions before you got to, if they don't have the money, what's the point of a 45-minute conversation?
Nada.
Yeah. Asad, you sell insurance. How important is it for you to qualify someone? Not insurance, so you sell mortgages. Excuse me.
Yeah, you got to qualify them like right there on the spot.
Absolutely. Anybody have a role play or a question they'd like to do?
I got a role play. I got this from a seller. Yeah, you know, I really want to sell the house, but I would certainly consider that lease purchase. I need some time to think about it. Could you call me back later?
No, can't.
But this is really something that I need to think about. It's a big decision.
I'm sorry. I'm crazy busy, sir. It's a lease purchasing is so many people are calling me about it and everything. You want to sell it as a lease purchase? And what would you like from me before I get off the phone?
I mean, you know, I really want to get it sold out, right? But you know,
then just go ahead and do it. I don't understand. What's the problem?
I just need time to think about whether the lease purchase is right for me. That's all.
Well, then keep thinking about it.
That's a good.
Sir, you called me. I'm not sure exactly. Why are we talking today?
I mean, you know, I posted my house up for sale, and you know,
great. People looked at it, right?
The last person, you know, they couldn't qualify for the loan. There's a lot of interest, but they just couldn't qualify for the loan.
It happens. A lot of people, like, a real estate's expense. A lot of people can't qualify. What's that have to do with me, though?
Like I said, I mean, I'm open to your offer. I'll consider it, but I just
Mike, what offer? I didn't make any offer.
Your lease purchase offer.
I help me out. I forgot. What was that offer?
It was like $10,000, $1,000 a month, and purchase at like...
Oh, you and I were going to do a deal on your property.
Yes.
And you didn't... When I made that offer 2 weeks ago, you didn't want to accept it. So what changed?
Oh, no, because I needed time to think about it.
Okay. Well, you've had 2 weeks.
Yeah. Can't get back to you later at 4 because you know, I just
can't, sir. I really got to go. In fact, I'm working on other deals and everything. Do you want to do this deal? Yes or no? It's okay to say no to me. I don't want to talk to you at 4 o'clock, much as I'd appreciate. I'd like to, but we're just going to have the same conversation again, right?
It's just a big decision that I need to think
about. And don't make it. It's okay. Stay in the property. Let it stay empty. Let it be vacant. Whatever reason you're doing that. Why are you even doing this deal?
Although, you know, like I said before, you know, I got divorced and my wife quit claim deed the house to me. So
okay, so now you and the Chihuahuas have a nice place to live.
Yeah, I just want it sold. So yeah, I mean,
why don't you stay there? I don't understand. Why don't you just stay there?
It's just, you know, I got to move on, you know.
But I made you an offer and you didn't accept it. Bottom line, sir, I really gotta leave. I have another appointment. Do you want to do this deal today? Yes or no? I'll meet you at 4 o'clock if you want to go ahead and do this deal today. Make a commitment and we do some paperwork. I just don't want to have a
let's talk at 4 o'clock so I can think about it.
What's gonna happen at 4 o'clock? No more think about it. Yes or no? What can we do?
There's a high probability that I think I could do this.
No, sir, no more wishy-washy words. Let's get to the point, please.
It's just that.
If you want to say no, say no. No more maybes, probably shoulds, coulds. I'll think about it. You can say yes, and I'll help you. You'll get a nice check. You'll get a nice contract. Your property will be well taken care of. You'll get payments for your mortgage. Everything will be great. You don't need a realtor, and we can do that if you say yes now. But I'm not going to do any more maybes.
Well, I read that sometimes, you know, at the end of the term.
Sir, I asked you a question. Yes or no? Because I've really got to go.
Let's just talk at 4 p.m. I got to go too.
Yes or no?
Most likely.
No, I'll assume that's a no, sir. Sorry. I got to go.
All right, fine.
So it was nice speaking to you again.
Thank you. Off the role play. Those are some great lines. Keep thinking about it.
Do you see why you did that? He did that really well, by the way. You did that very well. That is what a manipulative prospect, you know, if we had to put a frame around you right now, manipulative prospect, that's exactly what they sound like. No commitment, maybes, probably, should-haves, could-haves, obfuscations and everything. Why is it so important to work smart?
So you don't get frustrated and get burned out of all your time with prospects who aren't going to do anything in the first place.
Amen.
We all have 24 hours in the day.
Yeah. What's the difference between someone who values their time, knowledge, and energy and someone who just says, oh, I worked so hard. I talked with all these people and everything. And how much did you make? Well, nothing, but I really worked hard. I want to get commit. And probably you were thinking during that role play with Alan, you were probably thinking I'm being too assertive. Who thought that? Is assertiveness a bad word? I mean, if we've had a previous conversation, he wants another conversation. He wants to manipulate more of my time and he can't even make a yes or he can't even make a commitment for a future meeting and say yes or no. Just those maybes and everything. I told him he could say no, but he can't even do that. I think when we go, go ahead.
I think I the meeting because I was just going to one-on-one with us, but just want to give you a heads up.
I couldn't hear him. I'm sorry.
Me neither.
Well, I think that. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Sorry, receptionist. I originally booked a one-on-one meeting, but I'm not sure if I booked the wrong type of meeting. So I just want to give you a heads up on that.
I'm sorry, I'm not understanding your question.
Yeah, so I booked a one-on-one appointment, or we'll just talk about it afterwards. I booked a one-on-one appointment and realized we're going to do that with you, but we'll talk about it afterwards.
Your audio is, I'm sorry, your audio is garbled or something. So send me a text or something. Or
okay, thank you.
We got time for a question. Tiara.
Hi, yes. I feel like my struggles are having more openers for cold calling.
Okay.
I feel like I'm overusing the sticky note one.
I always have a pad here. Okay, use something different.
Okay.
So you mean an opener or pattern interrupt, getting back to somebody?
Yeah, like getting on the phone with somebody. Yeah, opening.
Okay.
Yeah.
Give me the, what kind of person are you calling, first of all?
I'm calling cold leads. Yeah. So I feel way more confident on like my openers are fine when I'm calling someone back.
We all do. That's the warm call. We love warm calls, right? Don't we?
Yeah. But I've been feeling like almost repetitive with like, hey, I seen your, I have my, your number here on a sticky note. And
how about you answer the phone. Hi, this is Tiara.
Hi, this is Tiara.
Hi, Tiara. Claude Diamond here. How can I help you?
You called me.
You're right. Absolutely. I've got something here in front of me. My desk is a mess. You ever have that? Is this about real estate?
I don't know. I mean, I do have a house that's,
and it's sold, and you sold it already, right?
No.
Would you like to sell it today?
Well, I don't know. What do you? I was not even thinking of selling it. It's just vacant right now.
Is this the house in Boulder, Aspen, or Fort Collins?
This is the house in Boulder.
Oh, I love Boulder. Oh, a great town. Can I ask you a few quick questions about it and then make you an offer? Maybe we can do business.
Yeah, I have a few minutes.
Oh, you're great. Thank you. Boom. Anything? This is the whole point of a pattern interrupt. That was called being a dope. Okay. Taking the stupid pill opener. Why am I calling? Say hello.
Hello.
Yeah. Why am I calling you?
You know what? Good question. I was hoping to talk to somebody.
You are lonely. Oh my God. We have a landline here. And honestly, we have a landline here that we don't use very often in North Carolina. It rings all day long with robocalls and stuff like that. I mean, 7, 8, 9 calls with no ID or anything like that. I mean, is anybody else getting inundated by that many garbage calls?
I pick up the phone and I'm like, hi, this call is being recorded for quality and training purposes. And it's silent for a second. And then they click.
Asad, is your connection better now?
Yeah, it's better now.
Oh, yes. Cheers. What did you say to me earlier? I didn't hear you.
Okay, guys. I was basically saying, because initially when I scheduled, I thought it was just going to be a one-on-one call with just you and me, but I think I may have clicked the wrong button because we were just going to work on like strictly role plays for mortgages, but that's fine. I'll just book another time.
We can do it. This is an entourage. Entourage is where I have up to 6 people and we can do any role play you want. I got a few more minutes left. Give me an insurance guy. Give me an insurance stall or objection.
It's actually mortgage.
A mortgage.
So FHA. So yeah, and what's your rate? So a mortgage. So the common objection that I get is, what's your rate?
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know?
I don't know.
Well, I mean, you can't tell me what the rate is.
I'd love to tell you the rate is. I don't know. See, here's your name, sir. I'm sorry.
It's Dennis.
Hi, Dennis. I'm Claude. When we say rate, we have a lot of rates on a lot of are we talking about a $5 million loan or a $1 million? You see my confusion here? Can you help me a little?
I want to know what are your rates?
I mean, we got a lot of rates. I got a book 3 inches thick with different rates. Rates for what? Can you just help me a little bit?
I want you to tell me what the rates are, or we're going to hang up the phone right now.
Go ahead.
I knew it. I was just thinking about that because when people were asking me rates, I was thinking like, what's a good rebuttal? And then that's when I realized, because I was looking at one of your old videos. I don't know, sir. What do you mean?
I don't know. We have. What happens when you get to somebody? This is the guy you're talking about, or girl, has been calling all over town. What's your rate? What's your rate? Okay, that's all they can say.
They don't care about the rates.
Mantra.
The truth be told, here's the thing: they don't care about what the rates are. A lot of times, they'll just use it just to get the person off the phone, or they'll just lie. Well, I have a 0.5% rate. Rates aren't that freaking low, so.
Oh yeah, you see, you have to say I don't know so that you get them emotionally involved. You know all the rates and you know generally what rate they're talking about. But if you say I don't know, is it a $5 million home, a $1 million, a $500,000? Is it FHA? Is it conventional? Is it a business? I mean, you have a multitude of rates if we really get down to it. But why do I say I don't know? It's called feigning ignorance. Why is that such an important, and this is good for you real estate folks too. Why is that such an important psychological trigger strategy?
It's simple. Other than getting the prospect emotional, it's for the prospect to give you the answer that you're looking for.
Yeah. I mean, if I do what the other 99, oh, well, the rate is 2.65% right now and we're having a special. Would you like to hear about it? And then we're going into that dialogue. I don't know anything about, I don't want to waste time with an unqualified prospect. So I'm going to say, can you help me a little bit, sir? People love to rescue, by the way. Can you help me? I'm lost. Do you know where's the nearest Chuck E. Cheese pizza parlor? Hey, I'm so lost. You know, you go to anybody and you ask for directions. You ask for, it's a great question. I don't really know. What are we talking about here, sir? Can you give me a little bit more information so I can help you? And then if he gets testy, if he gets a little nasty, sir, you're having a bad day, aren't you? Is it time to switch to decaf? Sir, what's happening? You sound like you're mad at me. Tell me, here, the apology. Look back in the role play. Sir, sounds like you're mad at me. I'm sorry. Tell me what I did wrong so I can apologize.
No, I just want to know what the rates are.
I don't know. Same answer. Can you give me a little bit more information? Are we talking about, are you buying something, a condo or a house or raw land or what kind of, we're talking about property, sir?
Yeah, well, we're talking about the mortgage, but the thing is that you called me. I didn't call you.
Oh, why am I calling you then? You're not in the mood. You're not looking to finance or refinance anything right now, are you?
No, I'm not.
Oh, okay.
I mean,
You're still living in Del Mar, sir?
Yeah, I'm still living in Del Mar, but why's that important?
That's what it's about. Wait, now I remember. You have a house in Del Mar. You have an $862,000 mortgage, round numbers. And you have a 6.3% mortgage. Suppose I could save you 2.5 points, save you maybe about $2,300 a month. That isn't of interest to you, is it?
Well, I mean, yeah, it is. But I mean, going back to it, what's the rate?
Oh, the rate for that right now, I can. We have a rate on high-end homes close to $1 million right now. I have a rate that's a lot less than what you're having right now. It changes all the time. I think right now it's roughly 3.2%. Is that Is that what you were looking? Is that worth changing and saving thousands of dollars for?
Nah, well, you know what? My rate is 1.75%. So
then keep it.
I'm good.
And I'm wrong. Keep it. No sense changing a rate. No sense changing a rate unless you want to pull some cash out.
No, I don't want to pull cash out.
Well, then you know what? You got a low rate and you don't need the cash. What do you do for a living, sir? I could learn from a guy like you.
That's none of your business. Click.
Okay. See, it's not over. I don't hang up. They might hang up. I laugh when they hang up because, you know, it's funny to me because I never hang up. It's over when I say it's over.
That's only a very small fraction of the people. But you know why they're really ask that question is because when the callers call them, they sound like a salesman. That's why they get that objection. Mm-hmm. I can almost for certain guarantee you. Because if you're just straight up with them, like when you do a pattern interrupt call and tell them like, hey man, you got a problem. Dude, yeah. you have this FHA loan, $800,000. Yeah. You're getting screwed on mortgage insurance premium. Suppose I could do this, 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 and this and get your rate lower. We couldn't do business. We couldn't do business today, could we?
Exactly.
Because you're just not being straight up.
And get right straight up. Ring, ring.
Hello?
Yeah. Mr. Dennis?
Yeah, this is Dennis.
Yeah. Hi, this is Claude Diamond. My calculator says I can save you about $2,100 a month. Nice. Right here.
$2,100 a month?
A lot of money.
What are you talking about?
$25,000 a year or more? That's a lot of money.
Yeah, it's a lot of money, but who are you calling from?
I'm over here in the Escondido office.
Escondido office?
Yeah. Let me introduce myself. You know what? I do this all the time. I'm sorry. I just jump ahead of everything. My name's Claude Diamond. And my research advisor told me that you have an $863,000 mortgage at 6.8%. Is that still true?
Yeah, but I'm not
looking to
refinance.
That's horrible. That's the worst loan I've seen in months. Why? You're paying thousands of dollars, way too much money, sir. And what I do is I help people save a lot of money, tens of thousands of dollars. Can I help you today? Or should I get lost?
You're going to help. You're telling me you're going to help me save over what you said, $2,300 a month on my mortgage?
Maybe more.
Well, how are you going to do that?
That's a great question. Hey, can we switch? You have an iPhone, sir?
Yes, I do.
Let's go to FaceTime. I want to meet you.
Okay.
Boom.
Yeah, but
you hear those moments? Okay. You hear those uncomfortable moments of silence, by the way? Anyone here ever go on a blind
date? Yeah, I know you did that.
You ever go on a blind date and there's those long moments of silence? Oh, shit, what am I going to say next? You get so nervous, you don't know what to say. And the conversation has these real long, pregnant pauses. Very uncomfortable, aren't they?
Yep.
You're a deer in the headlight.
It builds tension.
Yeah. And
you did that on purpose to build tension.
Yes. Sometimes you don't want to do it on a blind date, but you want in business. Sometimes don't answer the question that you just gave. Wait, that silence. It feels like hours, doesn't it? It's only a few seconds.
Yep.
And it's like you're dying to jump in. And that's what your amateur salespeople do when they know the prospect doesn't have an answer, but you just wait. This is how we get information and motivation. We wait. And I hit you right up front. The pattern interrupts right away. I'm confused. I'm sorry it took me so long to get back to you. Can you help me? Do you know you have a problem? Yes. How can I help? How can I help you? You know, and you act like he called you. That's a fun one. That is so much. Has everyone here done that? When you call,
yeah, somebody, you know,
say hello and you say, how can I help you? It is fun.
I think I finally figure out what you mean. And going back to Alex or Tierra Aguilar, because I had the same issue you had because you were talking a lot about the pattern interrupt. When we were talking last week, Claude, you said know what you're about to say. But one thing I noticed when I looked at reviewing your pattern interrupts is always this. There's a problem And they're so in business, obviously the customer has a problem, you have a solution. So I know this a lot of times.
Yeah.
You always address some type of problem and then you want to end off with, I have a solution.
Wrong finger.
And then, well, sorry. So you have a problem, I have a solution. But in between that, there's a little banter going on. But sometimes as us, the prospect will say something that'll kind of like knock us off our game or that'll knock us off our game. But
you cannot anticipate every response they're going to say. But what's the point of all everything we've been doing here for 43 minutes? What's the point of doing the things that I'm talking about? Why are we doing all this? Why are we doing all these little things? So we can get into a conversation. We've lost the ability, the art of engaging people spontaneously. We've lost that skill. We're texting too much or something like that. We've got to get that skill back so that when we talk to somebody, people love people. Okay. They just don't want to be trapped by a salesperson, do they?
Does it do the same thing?
All the robocalls. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
You're doing the same thing that my improv coach said, and you just said it right there. And he just said it, being spontaneous, being able to come off of something or being able to say something just right off the cuff. But also when they kind of like throw you off, get back on course. And then with a question, I got what you're saying.
Best way to practice this, to be spontaneous, improvisational. So here it's this simple. I know we talk about a lot of psychology and the three steps and open and closed ended questions and everything. But when you really get down to it, sales is about engaging another person to like and trust you. Can we get on a supermarket line and talk with the person in front of us or behind us and engage them in a conversation, make them laugh, make them smile, make them like us? Can we spontaneously talk to the person, the Walmart greeter, the people? Do you ever talk to the people at the next table in a restaurant? I embarrass everybody all the time. I always do. I'll go to someone like Tiara, do this with me. You're in a table with Alex there, and I'm looking at your food. And I'm sorry to bother you folks. I'm sorry, ma'am. That steak looks so good. I hope you don't mind. What did you order there? That looks fantastic. You're making me so hungry. What is that?
Oh yeah, it's the best thing on the menu. Is the chef was saying that it was just made and that they just did it. It's not even actually on the menu yet. So if you ask them when they come by, he'll tell you all about it. It's their special that they have going on. It's awesome.
Oh, thank you. So I'm sorry to bother you, but it made me so hungry. I just came in here with my wife and I saw what you were getting, and I'm a Gemini. I said, I got to get that thing off the role play. Did you see her smile and engage with me I don't think Tiara had any encumbrances or reservations about speaking to me in that setting with the words I used. Did she? Mm-mm. Sorry?
There was no agenda behind it. You were just genuinely interested and you weren't thinking about, oh, what
did
I need
feel
to
threatened?
Say this or...
Was she threatened?
No.
And you, I'm sure, has that ever happened to you in a restaurant? It's happened to me, or I do it to other people.
I do it all the time.
I do it too. If that's the skills I'm talking about here that are so important, by saying the right words to somebody, even if they're by themselves, so they don't think you're hitting on them or something like that, okay? You don't want to make anybody uncomfortable. But if you say the right words, so that they don't know so there's no creep effect. You know, you're just saying something. Oh my God, what are you drink? Oh, Alan, excuse me, sir, what are you drinking there? That purple drink with the umbrellas and everything in it, that looks fantastic.
Well, thanks for asking. Yeah, I don't know. This is probably too strong for you. It's great Kool-Aid.
It is. What kind of liquor is in there?
Oh, it's that heavy H2O.
Oh, okay. So no vodka or rum or anything, huh? Oh, okay. I don't want that drink. It's like, you know, you go to somebody in the supermarket line. If Assad, you're ahead of me in the supermarket. Oh, Lucky Charms. I've never had those. Are they good? Are they really good?
Yeah, you never had Lucky Charms?
I've never had Lucky Charms. What do they look? Is that the box has got a cute little leprechaun on it on the red box and everything. Is that a good? I love cereal. I mean, I got Count Chocula here and my Rice Krispies, yeah, and everything, but I've never had Lucky Charms. Is it a good cereal to get?
Yeah, it's a good cereal, but just once you hit like a certain age as an adult, I mean, it's just not, it's not good for you.
Well, you're no spring chicken and you're eating them, right?
Oh, no, man. I'm an old chicken, or I'm starting to become an old chicken. I got a little gray coming here. My starting to go a little bald at the top right
what
here.
What I so. Do, cheap hair dye, Safeway, you know, boom. Once a month, it keeps you young.
I don't care about the hair dye. I just care about losing my hair.
See how easy it is to get somebody. Do you ever go to somebody in a car? You're looking for a car and you see somebody in the car you're looking to buy. Tiara, I love that Honda. I'm sorry, I don't know your name. Do you like your Honda, ma'am? I'm sorry to bother you, but I'm thinking of getting a car just like that.
Hi, yeah, you know, I love this thing. It gets me to and from, and it's cheap on gas. I love the thing.
It is so cool looking. I love this car. It's, oh my God, and it's good on gas, you said?
Yeah. When do you think about getting your car?
You know, my wife and I are going to be looking. I said my wife and I, to make you feel safe. Maybe we're in a parking lot. A strange guy coming up to you, right? Women, you know, you got your alerts going, right? True? Mm-hmm. Okay. Is there a wrong way? I go jogging every day. And I'm one of these guys that when I go past people, good morning, how are you and everything. And some people are so scared. I study human behavior all the time. Some people are so scared. They start looking at their phone or start looking the other way or pretend like they're talking on the phone. Do you ever notice that? I engage people all the time. I just practice. But I like saying good morning to people when I'm running in the morning and everything. Or if they have dogs, I'll say, oh, I love your pug. I love your golden retriever. It's what a great dog. You know, you compliment. If you throw a compliment at people or you say safe words, my wife and I are looking for a car. Something like that. You can engage with people and let them feel like you're safe.
Mm-hmm.
All the time. This is the spontaneous practice that you have to do safely so that you can engage people on the phone and know what to say. They might ask you an oddball question or something like that, and you're relaxed enough. You ever notice when you get, what happens when you start getting tense?
Start getting in your head. You can't think straight and you forget what to say. It's the same thing as, you know, approaching a girl. And you forget what to say sometimes. Sounds like when I was younger, but yeah, because you're in your head a lot, and when you're in your head a lot, your mind, it just freezes up.
I'm gonna put Tiara on the spot. Tiara, are we in an environment today where girls can approach guys that they maybe want to engage in a conversation? Nothing is. Are we in a society where a woman can engage a man without giving off ugly vibes?
I believe so.
Okay. And especially in business and stuff like that. We have to learn to engage spontaneously and we have to be so relaxed. Just so, you know, when you're relaxed and the brain's working so great, everything's just, you know, the answers. And so, it's like watching Jeopardy. Oh, I know that answer. You know, and you sat out and stuff like that. But when you get tense or you feel self-conscious, all of a sudden, everything freezes. If we in business can just stay that relaxed, and Asad, this is to what your coach is probably leading up to. Staying relaxed. You ever wonder about comedians? You know, you were talking about improvisation, like actors or comedians. Yeah. How do you get in front of an audience and be that? You ever see them when people are so relaxed, so comfortable that they can even do stuff that's not prepared?
Exactly. And it comes, he was telling me it comes with hours and hours and hours of practice. He was telling me if you practice improv for about, let's just say 3 hours, maybe 90 minutes, but if you really are serious, if you practice it for about 3 hours a day for, let's just say 45, 90 days, the ability to just come off the cuff will just, it'll just be so natural to you because at that point, it's, you've removed that mental barrier that you have.
Why is this?
You just practice so much.
Why is this topic
before we go, so important in business and sales. Why are we talking about it? Why is being this comfortable and practicing role-playing and spontaneity, why is this so important in sales, Tiara?
I believe it's because we then come off like the professionals that we are instead of coming off like salesmen.
Yeah. Alan, what do you think?
You never know what you're going to get in a business communication or call. So the more you practice, at least when you get hit with an objective, you're like, oh, I remember that objective from the role play. So you can then apply that.
Yeah. And it's just, Saad, it's just practicing something so much that driving a car, I think, is the best analogy I can make. Remember when we first started driving cars, 16, 17, 18 years old, and we were like, you know, white knuckle time, we used to call it, where you'd hold that steering wheel so tight, and you'd look and check in the mirror and you're, you know, and all that. And today you get in your car, do you even think about it?
Yeah.
You hop in, you don't even know you're putting on your seatbelt. You don't even know you're hitting the button or turning the key, or your foot's on the, it's also autonomous now. Can you imagine if you could make sales like that, where you're just so relaxed and you know the right thing to say at the right time, even if you know you won't stand up, you won't have to be, you're not going to be manipulated or lied to or waste a lot of time. That's how you get to high income goals. You're just selling so much better, and you understand empathy. You understand how that other person thinks and feels. And you say the right word, the right question at the right time. And all of a sudden, the math, the forces of the universe are in your favor for closing. Good stuff?
Excellent.
See you guys. You kept me on much. I'm late as hell. But I'll see you later.
All right.
Thanks, Claude. Bye, guys.
Thank you. Good stuff.